Today, we move away from the hypothetical and we shift our Kubernetes setup from being in development using minikube to using the Google Container Engine in the Google Cloud, spinning up our first real cluster. Today, we have to run through quite a few things. First things first, we're going to set up our Google Cloud account, get our project ready to go. Then we're going to spin up a Kubernetes cluster inside of the Google Cloud. And then we're going to deploy our application as it exists from the previous tutorial into the Google Cloud. We'll have to make some slight modifications along the way, but they'll be pretty simple. The first thing you'll need to do is go to cloud.google.com. I'm already logged in, so it won't look exactly the same for you, but there should be something here to try for free. And what they'll actually do is they'll give you a free $300 credit to any of the systems inside of the Google Cloud, and that'll allow you to go follow along with me right now and actually get everything set up the way you would with real production grade cloud hosting. So go through the signup process now, and then you can follow along from there. The next place that you'll actually end up is going to be inside of the Google Cloud console. It'll give you a default project, which will have some sort of weird name that's just sort of auto-generated, and that's totally fine for following along with the steps that you're going to be going through right now. So don't worry about that. We're not actually going to poke around in here too much right now, because the next thing you need to do is actually to get the command line utility for Google Cloud. And you can find that at cloud.google.com/sdk/docs. And then they have the individual install instructions for the operating systems that you might be using. Once you've followed all of these instructions, you're going to need to do something a little bit different. And for you to be able to do Google Cloud from anywhere, you're going to need to make sure that it's in your path. For me to modify my path while I'm using bash, I need to take a look at my .bashrc file. And then you can see on line 7 here that I have re-exported my path to include the home google-cloud-sdk directories sub bin directory there. So you're going to need to do that too. The instructions really don't tell you to set it up this way, but you're going to have this cloud SDK directory, and you're going to want to move this somewhere so that you can actually add it to your path. Move it somewhere where you're not going to delete it. Now that you have the Google Cloud tool installed, we're going to need to do one more thing, and that's going to be to look at the components. So if you look at all of these, you'll see that there are quite a few of them in here, and it's kind of hard to read with how big this font is. But one thing you're going to need to do is make sure that the kubectl one is actually installed, and you might already have kubectl in your path based on the fact that you were using minikube. So you'll have to potentially delete that from your path and then re-add this, and you'll add this by doing gcloud components install kubectl. So you'll want to do this before we continue on also. We have the kubectl component installed, but we're not quite ready to continue going, and that's because we need to set a little bit more configuration, and then we need to make sure that we have access to all of the APIs that we need to use. So for that, the first thing we're going to do is we're going to set our compute zone. So we're going to do gcloud config set compute slash zone, and then in my case, I'm going to use the US East 1D. So it's now set. And then if we bounce back over to our browser and we actually go and we look around, we want to look for the APIs. So let's go to the API manager, and then we need to see what APIs we actually have enabled. So right now we have these all enabled by default, but we actually need some more. So what we need to enable is we need to enable the Google Compute Engine API. That took a little while to actually enable, so I kind of cut out in the middle of that. But we also want to look for the container API. So we need the both of these two. We need the container engine and the container registry. So enable this one. And also enable this one. And then we can see that the container engine one is finished. And I imagine if we refresh the page, the registry will finish in due time also. There you go. They're both there. Cool. Now that we have the APIs that we are going to use enabled, it's time for us to go actually create our first Kubernetes cluster. So to create our cluster, we're going to use gcloud container clusters create, and then we give it a name. So this is the meal pan cube. And the container portion, that means the container engine, which we were talking about a second ago. And the Google container engine is the hosted Kubernetes solution that Google provides us in the Google Cloud. So we won't have to manage the installation of Kubernetes itself. Google will do that for us. We just manage using Kubernetes and deploying our own applications to it. This is going to spin up by default three nodes for us to work with. And they're kind of beefy nodes compared to what we've worked with in the past. They all have 3.75 gigabytes of RAM and one CPU apiece. So these might be a little bit bigger than you need. They're just using the defaults right now. And there are actually command line arguments you can pass to the command that we just used in order to use smaller machines or larger machines or multiple nodes, depending on what you need for your exact circumstance. While this is being created, I'll cut the video. That way you don't have to watch this thing spin. All right, our Kubernetes cluster is up and running, and by default, the kubectl should connect to it. So if we do kubectl get pods, no resources found because we just spun up this Kubernetes cluster. If you do run into an error with that one, go ahead and do gcloud auth application default login to get around that. So to get started, we're going to first create our database because it's kind of a foundational piece for us. And then we'll create the front end portion, and then we will create the meal plan portion. The one thing that we're going to have a little bit of a hard time working with is going to be the config map, because as you remember, that's not an object that's managed inside of a file like the rest of our objects. So we have to manually type it all out. So it's kind of a long one. I'm going to type it all in, and then we'll come back and talk through the changes that I had to make, which there are only a couple that I'm going to need to do. Okay, going through this config map, most of this is exactly the same as what we had before. The only real exception is the original config map that we created had the minikube host here instead. So we're going to call this Postgres because it's the name of our service, which this should have been updated, but we did it through editing the config map last time around. But the only new thing we have is right here. It's this from literal PG data, var lib PostgreSQL data, PG data. And the reason for this is actually highlighted in the docs for the Postgres image that we're using. But the way we're going to mount a volume into this when we're using Google Cloud works a little bit differently than the host volume stuff that we did before. And if you just mount it straight to the path that the entire database goes, which is to say to the var lib PostgreSQL data portion, you'll actually run into an issue that's a little bit weird to kind of grok, and it'll cause Postgres to not start. So we need a custom PG data that we're going to end up using. Now we can go and modify our deployment to work in production. So this will be deployments Postgres. And this is where it's going to get a little weird. We're actually going to just get rid of our persistent volume claim and persistent volume. And then we're not going to use that there either. So the reason for this is because working with Google Cloud, the way we're going to do this right now is we're actually going to use a Google Container Engine persistent disk. And then this is going to have a file system type, which we're going to use ext4. And then it's going to have a disk name of Postgres disk. And what this is just a storage container that we create outside of Kubernetes that we're able to mount in here as a volume. Our volume mount's going to stay exactly the same as it is, but then we're going to add an extra environment variable up here. So this will be PG data, no underscore on this one, and it'll just take a lowercase PG data. So the big difference here, obviously, being the volume and the fact that we got rid of the persistent volume. And you would still want a persistent volume if you were using this with something and you didn't know if you were working with the Google Container Engine or say AWS. But in this case, we do know what we're doing for our actual backend, and we're just going to use this directly. So save this. And then before we can actually go and create it, we need to create the disk that we just talked about. So for that, we're going to use gcloud compute, because this is in the Google Compute Engine. We're going to create a disk, so we'll use disks, create, and then we'll give it the size of 200 gigabytes, and call it Postgres disk. This is kind of a big, you know, volume for our app that we're kind of using as a toy. But the reason we do this is because if you create this with anything smaller, it'll tell you that you're going to run into some potential issues because it's just too small. All right. With that created, we can now do kubectl createf deployments Postgres like we have in the past. And we only need to create a service and deployment since we got rid of the persistent volume stuff. And that should be good to go. It'll take a little while for Postgres to actually start, but we'll check back in a minute to make sure that our container started properly. Moving on to our front end, the next thing that we're going to have to work with is the fact that we used an image that we directly built onto Minikube before. We can't do that in this particular situation, so we actually have to publish our image somewhere so that we can pull it down when we're actually creating the object in Kubernetes. So we have to build our new image, and then we're going to re-tag it as something very specific for putting it into the Google Container Registry, where we can use that to host our own custom images. So I'm not connected to Minikube anymore, so I'm going to actually have to build this image on a different Docker host. So if you're using Docker for Mac, you can do that. Or if you're using Docker Machine, you can do that also. So we're going to have to do Docker build. And then I called this before. We called it CoderJourney, meal plan, front end. And then we gave it the 1.0 tag. And you have to point this at the Nginx directory because we're building our front end image. Now we have to piece together what we're going to call this so that we can publish it to the Google Container Registry. And the first step to that is going to be getting the name of our project, the exact name. So if you do Google or gcloud project list, projects list, you'll take this project ID right here, which yours will obviously be different. And then what we're going to do is we're going to do Docker tag, and then this takes the original name. So our case, CoderJourney, meal plan, front end, 1.0. And then we're going to tag it with some very specific stuff. So gcr.io is the root that you're going to use, and you should use the one that's specific to where you're at. So there are a few options. I'm going to use us.gcr.io because I'm in the United States. You can sub this out for EU or Asia. And then it's going to be that project name slash the name of the image that you want. So we're going to call this meal plan front end. And then we'll can give it the tag of 1.0 again. So now that we have that tagged, what we're going to do is use the Google Cloud utility to run Docker. And we're going to pass it basically what the Docker command would be. And it's going to be push. And we're going to copy this. Paste that down in here. And this is going to go off and push it to that private Docker registry that we're creating in the Google Container Registry. So copying this again, just making sure we have it. Let's go and modify the deployment for our front end. And then we need to change this image. And this is actually all we need to change in this file. So we'll save that. We're not going to go and create this just yet because it's actually going to then run into an error because meal plan doesn't exist. It doesn't know what meal plan is yet. So we'll go make the modifications we need for meal plan also, and then we'll just spin all of these components up at the same time. So we need to also create the image, tag it, and then push the image for our meal plan. So we'll use docker build dash t coder journey meal plan 1.0. And then we'll build that with context right here because we're using the top-level Docker file. Now we'll tag this. So we'll use docker tag coder journey meal plan 1.0.0. And then we'll actually paste in the previous thing, and then we'll just get rid of this dash front end bit so that we don't have to retype all of that other stuff. And then if we do our gcloud docker, looking at this gcloud docker push part again, we'll just need to cut out the dash front end. And this one is actually going to probably take quite a long time because it's an image that's like 350 megabytes or so. So we'll come back when this is done. Okay, we're finally finished uploading. Now we can grab this, and then we'll go and we'll change the deployment for meal plan also. So go to the image line. and swap that out. That's the only line we need to change. So save it, and then now we can do kubectl create deployments meal plan. We'll do kubectl create services meal plan. We should probably just consolidate these into a single file at some point. Now we can also do kubectl create f deployments frontend. With all of our deployments and services created, we should be able to make sure that everything is up and running. Do kubectl get pods, and all of our containers are actually running. If any errors had happened, then these would be in a different status. So that's pretty good. That puts us in a spot where we can actually check out the logs on meal plan. So if we double click this, we do kubectl logs that. Yeah, we should see that we have an error here. But maybe not. Not yet. Oh, because we haven't tried connecting to it. But we don't have a database. That's the main problem that we have right now. So let's do kubectl get pods again. Copy your meal plan pod. And then we need to do kubectl exec, paste that pod ID in there. And then we'll pass in standard in, make it a TTY. Then we want to run bundle exec rake db setup and db migrate. Cool. We created our database and ran our migrations. Now we actually need to connect to our front end. So if we do kubectl get services, we'll see something that we haven't seen yet. And that is right here, we have a load balancer as the type of the service for meal plan. And so it actually gives it an external IP. And you'll see that we're currently pending right here because it's trying to spin up a load balancer in the back end. And what that means is it actually spins up a load balancer in the Google Cloud, which is a separate service that's maintained outside of Kubernetes. So it'll spin up a load balancer that it can point to and give us external IP addresses. So run this again, and you'll see that our front end now has an external IP. So if we copy this, and we go and we look at this in the web browser, you can see that our meal plan is currently running. So we're connected to Nginx, which is then routing to connect to the meal plan service, which then is load balancing among all of the nodes that are running inside of that service. So, well, not nodes, sorry, all of the replicas that are in that deployment. We currently only have one, but you could have multiples, and then it would actually balance the traffic accordingly. I hope that you enjoyed this tutorial. There are some additional steps that you can follow along with on the blog post, which you can find in the description of the YouTube video below, that'll show you how to delete everything that we created today so that you don't burn up the free credit that you have with Google Cloud on this project if you want to use it on something real. So be sure to follow those instructions if you want to, or if you want to just keep this up and running and follow along with next week's, where we continue to build on top of this, you can also do that. I hope that you enjoyed this tutorial, and if you did, please give it a thumbs up and leave a comment for me, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel. It really helps out a lot. Have a good week!